Super Mario Galaxy is definitely the game I was most looking forward to. I'd never played it before, and considering the fact that this game is way less popular than 64, there's way less chance for this game to be overrated. And it turns out that I was wrong, because this game is pretty goddamn shit. Sort of, I'll get into that later, but to be fair, it starts out pretty well with Mario going out to Peach's castle for a festival before Bowser comes in with the fucking spaceship and takes the entire castle away. It's a really good introduction scene, and it's like a little playground to test out the controls and moves. He doesn't control quite as well as in Mario Sunshine, but he has a new move to correct his jumps, like the hover mode in Sunshine, the spin. Since this is the Wii, you gotta shake the remote to perform this move. I should note that I don't have a Wii, I'm playing this on something that isn't the Wii and something that I refuse to mention. But I am using a regular Nintendo controller with no motion controls to play it, so I've mapped the X button to shaking the remote. And as much as I don't like motion controls in my games, it works pretty well here. It always responds to the remote shaking and I never saw any problems with it. But yeah, while this is also an attack, the main way you'll be using it is to correct your jumps or to reach higher platforms, as it functions as a little boost for your jump. It works well and makes falling due to bad controls pretty rare. He also has a simplified moveset. While this sounds bad, it typically isn't. Mario 64 had like a trillion different moves, and while that worked well enough for that game, they aren't all needed for this one considering the different level design quirks. Besides, half the moves in 64 you straight up won't use, so it's not much of a loss. As the name of the game implies, most of this adventure takes place in space, and I'm kinda mixed on it. It can look great, of course, but it can get stale eventually and you'll be begging for something different looking. The space aspect also ties into gameplay, with cool planetary gravity shenanigans being the focal point of this adventure. A lot of people really like this, but I gotta be honest, I'm not a huge fan of it. First off, you can't really do much with the idea of planetary gravity. You may assume part of a level taking place on a sphere is different from a flat space, but it really isn't. You could easily just replicate the planet as a flat space and it would essentially stay the same, considering the planetary gravity changes almost nothing beyond how it looks. There's a few clever ideas with the mechanic like these gravity changing walls, but given that there's almost no versatility with the gravity idea, it really is just style over substance with this one. It's also just disorienting sometimes, the controls can be really wonky when moving on the different sides of a planet, and it's just generally weird considering they could easily just flip the camera to Mario's rotation, but no, the game doesn't do that, and it's pretty obvious why, they just want it to look cool. I feel the biggest issue the game has is that it focuses way too much on making the player go, "Wow, that's fucking cool," that the game forgets to put any kind of effort into making the ideas and gimmicks involved executed well. Like in Freeze Flame Galaxy, you can often find this ice flower, and it's conceptually pretty cool, allowing you to skate quickly over ice. But that's all it does, and it rarely benefits the player other than allowing them to move across lava. But that benefit is barely anything, considering it's only put to use with one star. Even if it's a little fun to use, it's kind of a waste given not only is it used once, but it's not really something to just help with the star, it's only a requirement. Or the fire flower, which I can argue is executed even worse than the ice flower. It works almost the exact same as the 2D counterpart, allowing you to shoot fireballs. The only difference here is that it's temporary, like most other 3D Mario power-ups. But Nintendo kind of forgot to add anything that helps you aim it, which is fine in 2D, but it's extremely detrimental in 3D given there's an entire third dimension and a camera you gotta deal with. They could have easily given it a lock-on feature or at least given it a crosshair, but as it stands, this is a really shitty execution of a power-up. I guess since I'm talking about a power-up, I might as well talk about the rest. They kinda suck. Not that they're bad on their own, they all, well, most of them anyway, have cool ideas around them, but my issue with them is that the game will only have a few select sections of the game that are built around that power-up, and the power-up is only used there as opposed to throughout the entire game. This is an inherently bad approach to power-up design, as if a player really likes a power-up, they'll obviously be disappointed that they can't use it outside of the situations where it's meant to be used. But I guess I should talk about the power-ups themselves. The bee mushroom is the most common of these power-ups, and it's pretty cool. Much like the hover mode from Sunshine, the bee mushroom can make you hover, but unlike the hover mode, the bee mushroom is actively used for elevation. You can also climb on honeycomb walls. This is a pretty great power-up, and my only real complaint is that you can't use long jumps or side flips while you have it. Long jumps are pretty essential for movement in this game, and replacing it with just a standard jump is really unsatisfying. Still though, I wish this was used more throughout the game. The boo mushroom transforms Mario into, well, a boo. In this form, he can float indefinitely and go through caged walls, but if he touches touches any lights, he turns back to normal. This is a really cool power-up, and you can 100% form a ton of cool puzzles around it, but as it stands, I believe it's only used in the ghost level, which really sucks considering, again, it has so much potential. I think going forward, 3D Mario games should avoid this formula because it just limits the potential of power-ups with not much benefit. There is one power-up I'm glad is limited to a few levels though, because it's really not good at all. The Spring Mushroom. It makes you constantly jump very slowly, and if you press A as soon as Mario touches the ground, he jumps a lot higher. Not only is this not that creative, it's really annoying to use too, considering you can only move while airborne, so you just stop moving every time you touch the ground. It's pretty obnoxious. What's worse is that there's absolutely no creative ideas you could come up with around this power-up. I think the power-up would be better off if you could hover in the air for a few seconds by holding A, but as it is now, the power-up just sucks and has no potential whatsoever. But honestly, outside of the use of the power-ups in the levels themselves, the level designs are pretty good for the most part. Never stellar, it doesn't go much beyond good, but it's never flat out shit either. They're also filled with creative set pieces like this worm for Gusty Garden Galaxy, or this giant 8-bit Mario in Toy Time Galaxy. But the best part of the levels is how you access them, through the hub world. The Comet Observatory. I really fucking love this place, it's really cozy and pretty with all the lights and decorations everywhere, and I love how it's built like a really small town. I also really like the different sections, they add a lot of flavor, like the grassy area being sort of a mini park, or the library area being a sort of open chill area, or even down to this little balcony the average player wouldn't even notice. These little rooms that hold the different worlds are really nice too, with my only real complaint being that they all have the same shape and size. But they look really nice and comfortable, with my favorite being the kitchen. They also have this big screen that displays a map of the observatory, but I like to imagine they watch movies here too. You know, what is Rosalina's favorite movie anyway? I feel like it's Ratatouille. I also just like the idea of there being almost no walls other than the library and the world select rooms. The vast emptiness of space adds to it a lot, and I feel like the place wouldn't be nearly as memorable without it. But yeah, I fucking love this place, and I'd love to see it return as a hub world someday. It also functions well too. The last two games, especially Mario 64, had a problem with some of the levels being a chore to reach. Every world here is really accessible without needing to get a certain power up or do some tricky platforming. But honestly, it says a ton about the game itself that hanging out here and exploring is like 10 times more fun than most of the actual game. Seriously, the game is pretty fun for like the first world, and after that the game starts to get really boring. Like boring to the point where I was considering turning off the game, and so far I've only done that for the lost levels. But I stuck it out to the end, and you know what? I'm kinda glad I did, because it proves for me fucking tenfold that the game doesn't get good again until the very end. The more I played the game, the more I wanted to rip my fucking hair out. It's so boring. It gets super fucking repetitive after the good stuff, and a large part of that has to do with the fucking atrocious padding. It was pretty obvious that they were padding the game out with Mario Sunshine, but it's even more obvious here, and it's so much more annoying. See, the star requirements for extra levels and worlds almost never become intrusive. It's at the end when the game gets really carried away with it. Once you unlock World 5, the second last world, the game shows you how many stars you need to reach the last level, which isn't in any given world. For people who really like this game, this number wouldn't be that high considering they probably got all the stars from many of the previous levels, but for a normal person like me who just wants to beat the game as soon as possible, the amount of stars you'll need at that very moment isn't 8 or 12, it's like 25! Yes, you fucking heard me right, you essentially have to double your star count, meaning you not only have to get every star in World 5, you have to get like 16 more stars after that, meaning you have to play boring ass levels just to get some more boring ass stars and feel unsatisfied with your purchase by the end of the game. So who the fuck cares at this point?
No, what's the number?
26!
Fucking stars.
Not even the bosses are that great. They could have been the only saving grace of this game, but most of them are forgettable at best. As with New Super Mario Bros, I'm only going to be talking about the bosses I've actually done. I'm not going to go back to play more of the game just to fight bosses that might not even be that good. Also, I'll skip some of the bosses that aren't too interesting to talk about. Dino Piranha is the first boss, and he's got this weird rock thing on his tail. You gotta get behind him and hit it back into him. It's not even the best concept, but it's dumbfoundingly easy. I know it's the tutorial boss, but you could have made it a little harder. King Caliente is way better. He sits in lava and shoots coconuts and fire rocks at Mario, and you gotta hit the coconuts back into him. It starts off pretty simple, but he eventually starts doing this back and forth type thing, and it's pretty fun. Not great and all, but it's a great concept that can be improved upon. Bugaboom isn't that good though, which is disappointing considering I quite like Honey Hype Galaxy. You're gonna use B Mario to climb on these honey walls and Grand Panda when he passes by. It's not even that good of an idea considering how simple it is, but they further fucked it up by making the timing surprisingly precise on that last hit. He moves far too fast there. I can say the same about Mega Leg, the first Bowser Jr. boss, though he's not really that much of a boss and is more of a puzzle. You gotta climb up his legs and onto his head where bullet bills shoot at. You gotta guide these bullet bills to the cage doors on the top of his head, and after that you need to guide another bullet bill to the cage the star is trapped in. It's a cool idea, but it's way too easy to pull up considering the cage doors don't move that fast. Top Maniac, despite having a cool design, really fails to deliver on the cool concept. You gotta step on his head, which retracts the blades on the outside of the body, and after that you can whack him into the electricity on the outside. Repeat that 3 times and he's dead, but it's almost mindlessly easy. His only real defenses are these 3 mini versions that do nothing but knock you back, and you can take them out really easily, it's just pointless. Poltergeist is alright, pretty decent. He shoots rocks and brings spikes up from the ground. Some of these rocks he shoots spawn these bamboos that you gotta whack back into him for a hit. It would have been decent, but he has a second phase after 4 hits that just gives him a new attack, and that's basically it. It just drags on for way too long. Still a pretty decent idea, which is what I can't say for Bowser Jr. He's basically just an advanced version of Carmelo where you have to fire green shells at him. I do think it is better because he shoots cannonballs, but he could have separated himself more from Carmelo. He does turn his ship forward on the last hit, making it so that the Bowser face shoots fireballs, but also makes the ship slightly harder to hit. It's a cool addition, but he's still not that great. Same with Baron Burr. He's an ice cube guy and he perfectly shows off how underwhelming the fire flower is. You gotta get the ice flower to skate over to the water and climb up to him. After that you wait for him to Grand Panda and then hit him twice to get a hit. He's just really, really easy. He has like 2 attacks and they're really fucking easy to avoid. He's just a waste of time. Alright, finally a good boss again. Although much like Mega Leg, Mecha Bowser is much less of a boss than he is an objective. You gotta screw these screws in to get to the next section where you have to unscrew these bolts to remove this wall and go into this pipe. Then you gotta climb on his arm that moves around and unscrew this bolt to get to the final section, and here you gotta use the... Then you gotta climb his arm that moves around and unscrew this bolt to get to the final section, and here you gotta use the spring mushroom across this bridge, and go up here to Grand Pan these stone blocks to get the star. It's a super fun gauntlet of little challenges, but I do have to complain about one thing. This final part with the spring mushroom is clearly built around the spring's weakness of being slow, considering that directly in front of the bridge is this canyon you gotta avoid despite how slow you are. But over here, there's literally just a spring mushroom right after the bridge part, and it just ignores how it was built around the spring's slow movement. Why? I mean, it doesn't matter that much considering the rest of the boss is really good and it's a small segment, but given how underutilized the spring mushroom is, it'd be good to get something that makes use of it. But still, it's a really good boss and it certainly deserves some credit. And I think the only boss that beats him in terms of quality has got to be Bowser. He's a really great boss, so good that I don't even mind the repeat fights. He jumps in the air to create shockwave rings, and you got to dodge those. He'll occasionally do this stomp attack, and you got to lure him into doing it on these glass tiles to set his tail on fire. After that, you got to whack him on the tail and then whack him once he starts spinning around. After that, you got to rinse and repeat. Later on, you have to hit him an extra time when he's spinning around, and he moves way faster, making it harder and more satisfying to hit him. It's a super good boss, and even better once... Fuck off! Stop falling! It's a super good boss, and even better once the final confrontation rolls around. He has 3 different phases for the final battle. In the first one, rather than hitting the glass spots, he rolls into a boulder. You gotta hit his head specifically since hitting anything else doesn't do any damage. In the next one, he shoots fireballs and simply rolls into a ball himself, and you gotta hit these green balloon dings into him to make him start spinning. And the final one is just fantastic. It's a combination of the ball rolling, the fireballs, and the first confrontation with the glass spots to make an almost perfect finale. The only issue I have with this fight is that it's just a bit too easy. The fight itself is moderately difficult, but you can get health refills in the form of coins the entire way through. Still though, it's a brilliant fight and probably the best in the series. It's also really climactic as the final phase takes place in an orb of lava, which is sick. This is all really enhanced by the music. It is fucking fantastic and makes the game feel 10 times more climactic than it would have been otherwise. But I gotta say though, the level does not at all live up to the boss. And it's funny because it's like the best level into the game too, at least top 3. It's a really fun level, but it's not climactic enough. The song, while done well, doesn't feel like finality as much as it should be, and the level itself is just really short, around 2, maybe 3 minutes in length. It's still really fun, but fails at setting the stage for what's to come, and that song is especially disappointing. And it's weird too, because the soundtrack for this game is fantastic, like objectively the best so far. It's fully orchestrated with violins and trumpets and shit. It's really good and feels like an actual journey across the universe. Highlights for me include the Star Festival, Space Junk Galaxy, and of course the Comet Observatory theme. But after the Bowser fight, the game is done, and wow, what a mess that was. While I had a ton of praise for the game, it doesn't excuse the fact that over half the game is obscenely boring, and the game's just a mess of poor decisions and execution masked with great visuals. Luckily, the game ends really well, with Mario and Peach reuniting, Bowser fucking dying, saying goodbye to the Luma that gave him the spin ability, and the universe being reconstructed with all your past foes there to celebrate. It's a really good ending to this, not gonna lie, pretty shit game all things considered. There's a lot of positives to count, but at the end of the day, there's too many really big negatives to count, and I kinda hate it as a result. Again, a whole lot of positives, but at the end of the day, all of those are outweighed by my biggest problem. Remember when I said the level design was pretty good? I was mostly lying. In the first world and the first half of the second world, yeah, the shit's nice, but soon you'll realize how empty the levels get. And I think these parts of the game are hurt by the choice to add the planetary gravity. The planetary gravity could definitely be used for cool puzzles, sure. But not only is it not used in a unique way for a lot of the time, but it exists as a large crutch for the empty levels. Because in reality, if you took my idea from near the beginning of this video and made all the levels flat, it'd be especially noticeable that something was off about the levels. However, keeping the levels with the spherical planet shit allows the level designers to be a lot lazier with the levels themselves and make them super empty, and that is by far my biggest issue with the game. Mario Galaxy is going just in between Mario 64 and Sunshine for now. Its start is just good enough to inch it slightly above Mario Sunshine for me, but the lowest points are way, way worse than Mario 64's lowest points. I'm starting to get worried again. These 3D games that everyone seems to like are consistently becoming my least favorites. Let's hope the next 3D game fares better, but for now, I think it's time we enter the corporate era. I'm gonna be so drained by the end of this, but for now, I think we gotta move on to the next game.